Good afternoon, New York, and the rest of our listeners around the globe. My name is June Stoyer, and I'm the host of the Organic Bee Radio Show. Our podcast is available on iTunes, Zune, and you can also visit our website at www.theorganicbee.com. If you have any questions for our guests, there are many ways you can contact the show. You can post a question on our wall on Facebook, Skype us, send us a tweet on Twitter to @TheOrganicView, or you can contact me directly at June Stoyer. If you'd like to be on the show or would like to find out about sponsorship opportunities, please contact us at questions@TheOrganicView.com. On today's show, as we continue our special series called The Neonicotinoid View, my co-host Tom Theobald and I will be joined by Dr. Hank Tenekis to discuss his latest research titled Impact of Systemic Insecticides on Organisms and Ecosystems. The research examines the negative impacts that systemic insecticides have on organisms, populations, and ecosystems. The efficacy of these products in controlling the target pests is assumed and not dealt with here. Only the effects on non-target organisms and communities are considered. So I would first like to welcome to the show my co-host, Tom Theobald.
Hello.
Good afternoon, Tom.
Hello, June.
And our guest today, Dr. Hank Tenekis.
Hello, good June. Evening, Dr. Tenekis. Hello, Tom. Good to talk to you again.
Hello, Dr. Tenekis. It's good to talk.
Dr. Tenekis, could you kindly tell the audience about yourself and why you wrote Disaster in the Making?
Yes. Well, in July 2010, I published a discovery in the journal Toxicology, and my paper convincingly demonstrated that the risk of chronic exposure of arthropods, including bees, to a relatively new class of pesticides called neonicotinoids, which are mainly produced by biocrop science, had been severely underestimated. And there's general consensus now about this conclusion. And the discovery explained bee decline, and I was extremely concerned about the negative impact of these substances on biodiversity. A major disaster loomed, and I found myself compelled to publish a book to warn the general public about an impending environmental catastrophe, and I think I've succeeded.
Dr. Tenekis, maybe it would help just the listeners a bit if you could just briefly tell us what qualified you to make these conclusions.
Well, basically, what my discovery entails is that infinitesimally small exposure levels are associated with risk. And also, these compounds are leaching from soils. They contaminate the environment, and they pose a threat to non-target insects in general. So the disaster I was envisaging was that we might get a break in the food chain that would lead us into an environmental catastrophe. Because if you break one link in a food chain, then all of the organisms above that link are in threat of extinction.
What I was getting at, though, is I think your professional qualifications gave you a unique background to come to these conclusions, and I just thought it would be helpful to the listeners if they understood a little of your background.
Okay, well, I was basically trained in cancer research, and I spent in the 1980s, I spent quite some time at the German Cancer Research Center in Heidelberg, where I met one of the greatest cancer researchers of the 20th century, Hermann Drucke, who performed groundbreaking studies with carcinogenic substances and quantitative studies that established that chemical carcinogens were among the most dangerous chemicals that we know, where there is no safe dose level. And in 2009, I discovered that these neonicotinoid insecticides behaved in a very similar fashion. They caused cumulative toxicity, and there is no safe dose level. So that was really the starting point, and that's why I wrote the book.
How much of the chemicals are actually needed to devastate an ecosystem?
Well, if you only look at bees, the levels that are found in pollen at the moment will kill bees within a week. And that is clearly an unacceptable risk, because the bees are paramount importance, and we depend on the food that is pollinated by bees. So that is one example of how important or how great the threat is of these insecticides.
There has been a lot of argument on the part of the pesticide companies as to the dosage that's been used. And maybe at this point you could just explain a little bit, and I'm going to try to do this without stumbling, the Drucker-Kupfmuller equation. Could you just, in layman's terms, explain how that operates?
Well, basically, what the Drucker-Kupfmuller equation tells you is that the risk is of a lethal effect is reinforced by exposure time. Basically, what it means is that in the case of honeybees, that the lethal risk increases with more than a fourth power of time. And this is why the risks have been severely underestimated. If you spread the lethal dose over a longer period of time, then you need less of the compound. So to kill a bee within a short period of time requires a relatively high amount of compound. But to kill a bee, let's say over a long period of time, let's say within a fortnight or something, will take an infinitesimally small amount. And this is what has been underestimated.
And isn't it the practical reality that these substances will accumulate with successive usage and are very persistent, which means that essentially there is no safe dose, that there is no safe level?
Because the damage they cause is irreversible and cumulative. There is no safe dose at all. And this is what makes them so dangerous. That's what makes carcinogens so dangerous, because they attack the genome, and these insecticides attack the central nervous system, and they damage the central nervous system, and this damage is irreversible and cumulative. So basically what we're dealing with is an unacceptable risk.
Is there a message in that for mammals and specifically for humans?
Yes, there is a human aspect too, because these receptors that the neonicotinoids act upon, the so-called neonicotinic acetylcholine receptors, are very important in the developing brain. And basically, the neonicotinoids behave like nicotine, and nicotine exposure, such as through smoking, is a known risk factor for sudden infant death syndrome, for low birth weight infants, for attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and for autism. And when you look at the autism in California, since the introduction of the neonicotinoid insecticides in the early 1990s, there's been an exponential rise. So I'm very concerned that we may be putting a generation in jeopardy, in the sense that pesticides are undermining our children's health and intelligence.
Specifically the neonicotinoids in
That's
this
right.
case.
That's right. Because they have the same receptor as nicotine.
Can you please explain why soil residue is an issue to key macroorganisms which maintain healthy soil?
Well, basically, if you treat seed with neonicotinoids, apparently approximately 98% of the neonicotinoid remains in the soil. And there are many insects in the soil that play a crucial role in the soil food web. And you will destroy these insects with the neonicotinoids. So again, you're breaking a food chain. And that may have terrible effects on the soil fertility in the long run.
Thank you. Can you also discuss your relationship with both Bayer and Syngenta?
Well, basically, I was later in my career, from 1985 to 1992, I was head of toxicology in a Swiss CRO, contract research organization, and we performed a lot of work for companies like Bayer and Ciba-Geigy, which is now Syngenta. And I developed very friendly relationships with my colleagues at Bayer and Syngenta. So I really expected, after I published my discovery, I really expected that they would contact me and that we would have initiated a dialogue on the issue, trying to devise new risk assessment guidelines that then would have to be approved by the regulators. And that would obviously have meant that some neonicotinoid insecticides would have to be withdrawn from the market. But that's happening all the time in the agrochemical industry. Companies are constantly developing new products, building on existing know-how and experience with the first product of a new substance class. But unfortunately, that it didn't happen. I received a note from the editor-in-chief of the journal Toxicology, informing me about a letter to the editor by two employees of Biocrop Science with a request to respond. And it was a very opportunistic attempt to disprove my discovery. And moreover, the Bayer employees denied that there was an underestimation of risk of chronic exposure of arthropods. And that was a blatant attempt to discredit my reputation as a toxicologist. I replied, and I think I destroyed the Bayer Crop Science manuscript. At least that's how I see it. And that was the start of a nasty confrontation that's probably going to harm both parties.
Now, it's very interesting that basically what you experienced is what happened with these companies. But I think that it's also important to share at this point with our audience exactly why these particular class of chemicals were developed. So could you please take a moment and explain to our audience a little bit of the background for the development of systemic pesticides?
Well, basically, the example is nicotine in the tobacco plant. The tobacco plant actually synthesizes nicotine to keep the insects away from the plant. So nicotine is circulated throughout the tobacco plant, and whenever an insect takes a chunk of the tobacco plant, the creature is being poisoned with nicotine. Now, that's been the basis of designing these neonicotinoid insecticides. Nicotine is interacting with a receptor in the central nervous system. So they actually manipulated the molecule, constructed other molecules that were interacting with this receptor. And they were successful with imidacloprid. And that was introduced in 1991. Now, the big advantage of neonicotinoid insecticide is that you don't have to spray it. You coat the seed with the compound, and the plant, once it grows, will take up the substance from the soil. So it has many advantages. The disadvantage, however, is that it also contaminates pollen and nectar. So it starts poisoning non-target insects. And that's basically the problem they've created.
With the use of the new technology, meaning the neonicotinoids, the argument has been that if the regulatory industry, or excuse me, the regulatory agencies eliminate their use, that the farmers are going to be forced to go back to using older technologies, and that agriculture will fail, and we're going to see massive losses as far as crop production.
Yes.
What exactly will this mean to the farming community if the neonicotinoids are in fact banned?
It will mean that there's going to be a transition period, and that we may have to use other ways of combating pests. But the organic agriculture is showing that you can actually get to terms with most pests. So I don't think that there are no alternatives.
I think what's being missed in this discussion, in this argument, is that despite the use of the neonicotinoids, the chemical applications have increased significantly. It was presented to the farmers as a way to get away from these applications, but in the face of the failure of these neonicotinoids, and they fail by design, the pressure for pest resistance development is enormous. So the farmers are using these old chemicals anyway.
Yeah, that's right. They have to, because they're facing a resistance problem, and they're going to face a resistance problem with the neonicotinoids as well. So that's very true, Tom. But I think my personal view is that we have to move away after 60 years of chemical pest control. We have to find other methods of pest control, and apparently biological pest control is in a very advanced state, but the problem is that it's very difficult to get it approved by regulators.
Dr. Tenekes, I know none of us have a crystal ball, and certainly you don't either, but could you just give us an idea of what might be expected environmentally if we do nothing, if we don't withdraw these neonicotinoids from the market? What would you expect is going to happen, and what is already happening?
Well, it's already happening. It was immediately clear to me in 2009 what the implications would be. What is going to happen is that that we will get a break in the food chain. Insects are important pollinators, but also they are an important food source for many organisms, the fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, game birds, and songbirds, all depend on insects. And because we're polluting the planet with these neonicotinoid insecticides, we are basically exterminating the insects. These compounds are diffusing through the environment. They kill or debilitate non-target insects and progressively reduce invertebrate prey for higher organisms. And also, there's experimental evidence of immune suppression in bees and fish. And there have been outbreaks of infectious diseases in honeybees, in bumblebees, in fish, amphibians, bats, and birds in the past 2 decades. And the disease outbreaks started in countries and regions where neonicotinoid insecticides were used for the first time, and later they spread to other countries.
Isn't one of the modes of action of these neonicotinoids to compromise the immune system?
Well, that's one of the effects we're seeing. Jeff Pettis of the USDA has convincingly shown that there are that the immune system is being compromised by very, very small doses of these neonicotinoid insecticides. So in effect, neonicotinoids are weakening the insects' immune systems, and allow infections to spread through a hive.
So it wouldn't be unreasonable to expect the very symptoms that we're seeing in a wide range of species. Is that correct?
That's what I'm afraid of will happen. And if you look at the bumblebees, the species that have declined had significantly higher infection levels of the pathogen Nosema bombi. The frogs that have inhabited the thousands of lakes and ponds in California's Sierra Nevada are being wiped out by the citrate fungus and exposure to small doses of neonicotinoid insecticides is likely to have occurred. And this may have weakened the amphibian immune system such that they became more susceptible to pathogens. There's been a massive decline of bat populations in the United States, which is linked to infections. A powdery white nose tip was a characteristic of the disease, and it was found out that this was caused by a fungus, the Geometris destructans. It infected the skin and the wing membranes of bats and was associated with an unprecedented number of deaths, first found in a cave in New York in the 2005-2006 winter, and rapidly spreading throughout the northeastern states. And the thousands of invertebrates consuming it in their diet will inevitably have exposed bats to small cumulative doses of neonicotinoid insecticides. Now, there's been a conjunctivitis found in wild house finches in 1994 in Washington, D.C., and it was identified as a Mycoplasma gallisepticum, a pathogen of poultry that had not previously been associated with wild songbirds. And in the first 3 years, it just killed an estimated 225 million finches.
Imidacloprid was introduced in 1993, as I recall, in the United States.
1991 in the United States, as I recall. So shortly afterwards, we had this problem with house finches. Now, green finches have been devastated in Europe by infections of Trichomonas gallinae, protozoal organisms, and this started in the UK around 2005. And chaffinches were affected by papilloma virus. So there are all kinds of indications that immune suppression and
the high... Anidin was introduced in 2003.
That's right. And in Germany, there's been an outbreak of blackbird disease, which was caused by a tropical virus from Africa, the Usutu virus, and it's killed about 300,000 blackbirds in 2011. So there are all kinds of indications that previously unknown infections are spreading in wildlife. And it always concerns species that have been exposed to neonicotinoid insecticides. So it's very worrying, and we may be on our way to a collapse of the ecosystem. So we're really, to put it in a nutshell, we're on our way to Armageddon.
I just think that it's interesting that there are over 30 research studies that have been independently conducted, yet the manufacturers are insisting that there is no scientific evidence that proves that the neonicotinoids are responsible, but yet everything that you've just been saying for the last few minutes demonstrates very clearly that the common thread with all of these different organisms is exposure to neonicotinoids in one form or another, whether it's through the food chain or through direct contact or even indirect contact, as your paper demonstrates.
Yeah, that's right. In fact, it was put very, very neatly by the environmentalist Graham White, who said, what in effect is happening is that these insecticides are creating a toxic landscape in which many beneficial organisms are killed off. And we can't sustain these losses. This is, so what is in effect happening is the beginning of the end. It may be the end of life as we know it.
Dr. Tanakis, thank you so much for coming on the show today. It is always a pleasure to speak to you and to learn about the continued research that you and your fellow scientists have been working so diligently on, and also your efforts to raise awareness about the devastating effects of these systemic pesticides.
Well, thank you very much, June and Tom, for giving me this opportunity to talk to a large audience. Thank you.
Well, we always appreciate the efforts that you've put into this, Dr. Tanakis.
Thank you, Tom.
And folks, thank you so much for tuning in. This has been June Stoyer with the Organic View Radio Show. Have a great afternoon, everyone.